Hello and welcome to the channel Love Obstetrics and Gynecology. In this video, I'll explain you about the instruments that you require for a vaginal delivery. Beginning with the first one, first we require is a sponge holding forceps. So in the sponge holding forceps, this is required to clean the perineum of the patient or the vagina vulva area. So this is a sponge holding forceps. In the distal part, it has two rings, right? You can see this is the two rings, and inside these rings we have transverse serrations. And in the part fore part or the part towards you, proximal end, you can see that you have is a locking system. So here you can grasp your swab and then you can lock it off and clean the perineum of the patient. Also, this instrument in the vaginal delivery can be used after the delivery of the baby for the cervical tear exploration. So at that time you will require actually four of them, and we use the sponge holding forceps for the pregnant cervix lips because those are very edematous. And if we use Valsellum instead of this sponge holding forceps to hold the cervical lips, it will be very traumatic for the cervix. So we use the sponge holding forceps for the cleaning and for holding the cervical lips. The next that you require after cleaning the perineum of the patient is this instrument. This is known as the K90 urethral catheter, and you can see that this K90 does not have any balloon as you see in the Foley's catheter. So it is just an in and out procedure. In case you have a patient that is into labor and going to deliver and she has not passed urine yet, it is important for you to empty her bladder before the delivery of the baby. The next up we have is, this is known as the amnio hook. See, it has a sharp pointed edge at its tip. It is basically for the artificial rupture of membranes. See, the artificial rupture of membrane can be done early in labor also, right? At a 3 cm dilatation when you feel for the head of the baby to be engaged, that is the time you can go for a artificial rupture of membrane. And there can be many indications for it, like we are suspecting abruptio placenta, or we are suspecting for the meconium, or we want to just augment the labor. It is for that purpose when you do artificial rupture of membrane. And in case even after the full dilatation of the cervix, the membranes have not been ruptured, you can either use this amnio hook, or you can use a Cocker's forceps, or you can use a tooth forceps. See, this is a tooth forceps. The next up we have is, now we have cleaned the perineum, we have drained the bladder, and now the crowning is going to happen. And crowning is when the maximum diameter of the fetal head stretches the vulval outlet and the head does not recede back even after the contraction is over. So now is the time when you will give the episiotomy, and for that you require is a, first you need to infiltrate the perineum with the lignocaine 1% in a fan shaped manner where you want to plan a episiotomy. And for the episiotomy after that you require is this episiotomy scissor. See, this episiotomy scissor is bent, is not a straight scissor, it is bent over. So why is this bent? This is to aid the episiotomy, and episiotomy is given usually at a, usually it is given on the right side because we hold the scissors with the our right hand. In case the doctor prefers it to be on the left hand to be more effective, you can use, give a left mediolateral episiotomy. So in the right mediolateral episiotomy, basically you put two fingers inside the vagina, right, inside the vagina, right at where you plan to give the incision, and then guarding with these fingers, you are going to give your episiotomy at about a 60 degree angle over when the patient is crowning, right? Just when you suspect the crowning is happening, because that is the time when the perineum is maximally stretched and the blood loss will be minimal, right? And at that time you can exactly see which will be my site for the episiotomy. So the epi that you made at 60 degree angle will now, after the delivery of the baby, will be at about 45 degree angle. So now your baby has delivered. The next thing that you require is a pair of cord clamps. See, these are the cord clamps. These are instruments that can hold the cord in its distal portion, and these are actually kind of clamps that have transverse serrations in it and a lock at the end where you hold it with your hands. So this is a cord clamp, and you require two pairs of cord clamp, one for the maternal side, other for the baby. Now after clamping the cord, and in between these two clamps is where you want to cut your umbilical cord. So for cutting that umbilical cord, you require is a umbilical cord scissor. So this is an umbilical cord scissor. See, you can actually imagine that this is, if this cord has been clamped between these two cord clamps and I want to cut in between, see, it gets a very nice grip of the cord that is between its two blades, and the cord will not slip off. So this is a cord cutting scissor. The next is, we now your baby is delivered and the baby has been actually been given to the pediatrician, and now your main focus will be to deliver the placenta. For placenta delivery, you go for the AMTSL, that is the active management of third stage of labor. Within the delivery, within first minute of the delivery, administer 10 units oxytocin IM, and with the controlled cord traction, you deliver the placenta. After the delivery of the placenta, you now come to the management of the episiotomy. So for episiotomy, episiotomy is a type of a second degree perineal tear. You need to suture the mucosa, the muscles and the skin in three different layers. And for that you require is this. This is known as the Allis tissue holding forceps. See, this is also an instrument that has a lock in it and multiple teeth at its forepart or the business end, so as to hold the tissue that we are going to suture. For example, you want to hold the apex of the epi, you can hold it with the Allis tissue holding forceps. And also you require is a needle holder. This is a needle holder, right? So how do we identify a needle holder? See, the needle holder has a lock at the portion that you hold, and its distal part, you can see that there are crisscross pattern serrations and a groove in it. This groove is for holding the needle in its correct position while you are suturing. So this is my needle holder. The next we have is, this is a toothed forceps, tooth tissue holding forceps. See, toothed, why? Because it has 2 into 1 tooth at its distal end where you are going to hold the skin. So for episiotomy, you require basically is a needle holder and a toothed forceps. And how we are going to suture my episiotomy? We will require a chromic catgut number 0 suture And for suturing this episiotomy, I'll be suturing it in three different layers. Right? The first I'll suture is my mucosa. Mucosa is stitched in a continuous fashion. Right? You start 1 centimeter above the apex is the where you place your first suture, and then you continuously keep on coming continuously till the fauchet, and the second knot will be tied at the fauchet. The next muscle, next layer that we are going to suture is the muscle layer. The muscle layer is sutured with interrupted simple sutures. Simple interrupted sutures. The next, you come on to your skin. For skin, you require is a tooth forceps to hold the skin, and you give on skin again interrupted mattress sutures. Interrupted mattress sutures. And for all those layers, you require is a chromic catgut number 0. So this was all about your vaginal delivery instruments. Thank you. And if you like the video, please do like, subscribe and share the channel Love Obstetrics and Gynecology.